Madam Speaker, distinguished colleagues, Bill Gates once said, if there is any single thing you could lower the price of to eliminate poverty, by far, it would be the price of energy. Indeed, if the Philippines did not have power shortages post-1986 and consequently had lower electricity prices, would it not be then plausible to assume that we could have increased our GDP by an incremental, just an additional 1% for each of the years post-1986 until today? If we accept this premise, does it not imply that our economy should be at least around 36% larger than it is today? Our 2021 GDP was 21.6 trillion pesos. 36% larger is 29.38 trillion pesos. 7.78 trillion just for 2021 alone. Would that not equate to millions of jobs that never materialized? Higher pay? Would that not have meant that there would have been less or no deindustrialization, which forced so many to have to live and work abroad? The economic opportunity loss from this avoidance of the Philippines as an investment destination because of high power prices and grid fragility has not cost us millions or billions of pesos in lost opportunity. This has cost us trillions of pesos, and its effects continue to be trillions yearly to this day. And all that, if the incremental economic opportunity cost for not having nuclear was just 1% of GDP. Could it have been 2% more? I only remember that during the Asian boom times, some of our neighbors achieved double-digit growth rates. We did not. Could we have avoided the power shortages, the highly pollutive diesel power barges, the diesel generator on every street corner and commercial establishment, and in most government offices, the onerously high power cost to all citizens, and fragile grid that linger to this day? Mr. Speaker, distinguished colleagues, in a word, yes. Our 100% complete, BNPP completed its hot functional testing in March of 1984, generating approximately 5 megawatts on and off for several months, proving that it is not the white elephant its detractors want to make it out to be. BNPP is one of the last 4 two-loop nuclear plants designed in the first nuclear era by Westinghouse. The other 3 are Angra 1 in Brazil, KRSKO in Slovenia, Cori 2 in South Korea. These 3 are all running in their home countries and are award winners for uptime and reliability. In May of 1985, BNPP was subjected to inspection by IAEA's OSART 2 mission. OSART means Operational Safety Review Team, which came to the Philippines. And it received favorable endorsement. It was subsequently declared as ready for core loading with nuclear fuel. Reasons why it was not loaded and run are political in nature and can be found in then Energy Minister Jeronimo Velasco's memoirs. It had something to do with the then U.S. Ambassador Stephen Bosworth's what I consider meddling in the Philippines' internal affairs. February 1986 shortly came around, and the rest is history. Mr. Speaker, distinguished colleagues, BNPP could have opened the nuclear door for the Philippines just as it did in South Korea. South Korea has half our population. Kasabay lang po ng BNPP ang Coritu. Coritu paid for itself in about 6 years of operations. Today, Korea has 24 running nuclear plants, many of which are still in their amortization period. Electricity in Korea costs approximately 4 U.S. cents per kilowatt hour wholesale. That's approximately 2 pesos and 20 centavos per kilowatt hour wholesale. In the United States of America, where the almost 100-strong fleet operates, the plants are mostly fully amortized. There, according to EIA, Energy Information Administration, nuclear costs approximately 2.3 U.S. cents per kilowatt hour. That's 1 peso and 27 centavos per kilowatt hour wholesale. Imagine if we built nuclear plants instead of coal and gas plants since 1986, moving forward till today and onward. We probably would have kept pace with the economic development of our Korean brothers. But even if we did not, we probably would not be left as far behind as our approximately 20-to-1 lower per capita consumption of energy would indicate. In a way, that's a definition of our poverty. Mr. Speaker, distinguished colleagues, the charts depicted here illustrate how deadly various forms of energy are, including wind and solar. It can be seen that nuclear is the least deadly. And if we exclude Chernobyl, because it has no containment, and which has an all-time casualty rate of less than 50 since 1986, these charts would read zero for nuclear. The implication, Mr. Speaker, distinguished colleagues, is that nuclear has already saved over 2 million lives by avoiding all other forms of energy wherever it is located. The further implication, Mr. Speaker, distinguished colleagues, is that the coal and other fossil plants we have allowed and permitted in Bataan, Zambales, Pangasinan, Quezon, Batangas, Pampanga, Bulacan, Iloilo, Cebu, Misamis Oriental, Davao City, Davao del Sur, Sultan Kudarat, and other parts of the Philippines have cost a few thousand of premature deaths among Filipinos since 1986 until today. Lives which could have gone on to full expectation had we operated BNPP and built a nuclear fleet instead of a coal and gas fleet of power plants. And yet so few protest these. Mr. Speaker, distinguished colleagues, what enables nuclear to be magically cheap, clean yet reliable is the energy density of uranium, which is many millions of times higher than even the most potent of fossil fuels like gasoline, diesel, LNG, or coal. There's a chart for that. That's the wrong chart. The illustration below depicts comparison to uranium to these fossil fuels. You can see in the chart below also a depiction of the 51 Panamax-sized ships of 50,000 tons each needed to run a BNPP-sized coal plant for 18 months. The equivalent nuclear fuel is one jeepney a single time every 18 months. Mr. Speaker, distinguished colleagues, for each gigawatt of nuclear capacity we build, we will avoid at least $600 million of coal or LNG importation per year, maybe more since prices have risen since the Russian war. The equivalent nuclear fuel will cost approximately $20 to $30 million. Mr. Speaker, distinguished colleagues, we can totally eliminate the ocean shipping infrastructure and fleet of coal or LNG ships that keep our electricity and lights on. Surely, distinguished colleagues, this is a matter which impacts not only energy independence, but also economic security and national security itself. Mr. Speaker, distinguished colleagues, the ocean contains over 4.5 billion tons of self-replenishing natural uranium. To extract this, mining is not needed. Fibers which are placed in the sea and harvested every other month are what it takes. Ocean uranium already sets a price cap for uranium in the world. Mr. Speaker, distinguished colleagues, there are too many topics connected to nuclear to be covered in a single privileged speech. But let me just inform this August chamber that the EU Parliament, just a week or two ago, realizing that a green energy future is not attainable economically without nuclear, recently voted to include nuclear in its green investment taxonomy. This opens the door to tens of trillions of euro in financing for nuclear power. Allow me to end here for now. I am sure that I have raised enough points for you, my distinguished colleagues, to ponder. We shall tackle in the near future issues regarding nuclear. I look forward to sharing more of the information I have gathered over the last 15 years in future privileged speeches. Till then, mabuhay po kayong lahat, my dear colleagues, Mr. Speaker, mabuhay at maging masagana ang Pilipinas. Magandang gabi po sa inyong lahat.